Yes, this is your tutor, entrepreneurship tutor, Professor Henry Bwisa of Jomo Kenyatta University of Agriculture and Technology. Now, do you want to retire into your own business? Then this is for you. You are at the right place at the right time. I want to introduce you to 10 steps to start your own business from scratch. Now, globally, this blogger has some startup statistics at that site. He's calling it 106 must know startup statistics for 2020, Mproker. He's telling us that about 90% of startups fail. 10% of startups fail within the first year across all industries. Startup failure rates seem to be close to the same. Failure is most common for startups during years 2 through 5, with 70% falling into this category. Now, that is globally, as far as that blogger is concerned. And then a question arises, why do startups fail at that site, www.ppva.com? That question has been posed. And the main reason behind the failure of startups is said to be clear, that they simply fail to offer a product or a service the market wants. And we are told this was the cause cited by 42% of the entrepreneurs for the closure of their businesses in the cases examined by that CP Insights in 2018. Yes, I can tell you that in Africa, failure rates are very high. I have been in South Africa, I've been in Zambia, I've been in Nigeria, I've been in Ghana, I've been in Senegal, I've been in Egypt, I've been in Tanzania, I've been Tanzania, both mainland and Zanzibar, I've been in Ethiopia. I can tell you for sure that yes, in Africa, we have quite high failure rates. Mortality rate for businesses is very, very high. In my own little book, I have identified what I'm calling the Me Too syndrome for failure to go into business. One, people just go into business because a neighbor is doing well. They go on a Me Too syndrome. There are quite a number who go into business as a last resort. Like many of our graduates, when they fail to get wage employment, then they go into a business. There are some who go into business because they have been fired at their place of work. So the reasons are many. They fail because they are not ready. And therefore, Mukmik, my consultancy, has developed 10 steps for a startup process that will help improve the survival or success of business startups, people starting from scratch. We have the 10 steps. One, the problem. Two, who it affects, what we're calling customer segments. Three, the value proposition. If there's a problem, the solution must be thought. Four, when you are in business, you need to develop some customer relationships. Five, channels. You must carefully think about how you are going to reach your customers. Six, the key activities. Don't go into business before you identify which are the key activities. And 7, the resources that you will need. 8, the partners. This is sometimes overlooked. We shall talk about it. 9, have you thought about the cost? Have you identified the cost of going to business? And that is when you now finalize number 10, your revenue streams. So let's start. Number 1, the problem. Don't just start a business. Please solve a problem. As long as you offer a solution to consumers' problems, they will come looking for you. People will always look for better, faster, and smarter ways to accomplish their everyday tasks. And fortunately for entrepreneurs, there are still lots of rooms for improvement in existing products. So, how do you find these painful problems and match them with the best solutions possible? We think we could guide you if you so wish. So, identify a problem and address that problem. So that's first step. Number 2, who does that problem affect? That means look at your customer segments, which are divisions of customer base into groups of individuals that are similar in specific ways, such as age, gender, interest, and spending habits. Things to consider when you determine your customer segments include, but not limited to, whose problem are we solving? Are they other businesses like our own? Or are they individuals? How big a market do they constitute? A great place to start understanding your customer is to create customer personas for each of your customer segments. This again, we can help you do it. I was in a town in Kitale last week, and I saw this person who had started clothes, and he had actually, it was a lady, she had stocked men, women, children. She had not segmented, she had no core segment of the market. She was selling so long as their clothes. It was good, but not good enough. Market segmentation can help so that you have the core product and the supplementary market. The number 3, a value proposition. The solution that you're offering. You know, you had a problem. So a value proposition is a statement that answers the why customers should come to you and not to the competitors. Think about that one. It should convince a potential customer why your service or product would be of more value to them than similar offerings from your competition. Clearly, this means competitor analysis, and we could help you do this. The number 4, with your value proposition and customer segments taken care of, you will need to figure out the relationship you want to have with your customers. Remember, the customer is always key. Customer relationships is defined as how your business interacts with these customers. So, do you want to meet with them in person or over the phone? Or will you run your business predominantly online? So the relationships will be online too. A really helpful step is to create a user journey map for your customers as they interact with your business. Don't just go there, sit in your shop and wait for them to come. Please create these relationships and keep that relationship lively. Number 5, you are talking of the channels. Channels are defined as the avenue through which your customers come into contact with your business and become part of your sales cycle. This is generally covered under the marketing plan for your business. So, good questions to ask when identifying the channels to reach your customers include, but again, not limited to, how are we going to tell our customer segments about our value proposition? Think about that. Many people start their businesses, but they have no idea how they are going to reach the customers. So you have the product and it stays there. Number six, the key activities of your business. These are the actions that your business undertakes to achieve value proposition for your customers. Questions to ask include, what activities does the business undertake in achieving the value proposition for the customers? List all the activities that you're going to undertake. If you don't list them, you are likely to be groping in the darkness. You start one activity, you find you needed another one. I remember when I was still a young man, I was employed in a second school, girls' second school, and I moved to the school with all my gadgets for my activities out there, including kitchen activities. But you see, I am a lawyer who likes posho, ugali, and ingoho chicken. And what did I not carry? The cooking stick. I couldn't do the activity of cooking my ugali the first day I was in this school. So, listing what you need is extremely important. Number seven, you should think about what practical resources. I've already talked about some of them in my example. What practical resources are needed to achieve the key activities or the actions for the business? Key means the resources your business requires to do the business. These resources are what is needed practically to undertake the action activities of your business. Office space, computers, what resources? Employees, all those, time, all those are resources that you must list even before you start. Again, if you miss one resource, it might be key. It's just like going to shop. It's advisable that you do a shopping list. So when you're out there in the shop, you pick what you already have planned. Number eight, we're talking of partners. Yes, you might think that you don't need partners, but these are external parties that you may need to achieve your key activities and deliver value to the customer. You may ask, if my business cannot achieve the value proposition alone, who else do I need to rely on to do it? For example, if I'm selling groceries to customers, I may need a local baker to supply fresh bread to my store. The issue of identifying business alliances arises too. Might you need a business alliance? For example, you are a doctor. Might you need business alliance between you, the pharmacist, and that mama mboga? Think about it. Look, a mother comes to your hospital with a sick child. You subscribe medicine. And if you are in business alliance with a pharmacist, you signpost that patient to the pharmacist. You say, I know where you're going to get the best drugs. He goes to the pharmacist, buys the medicine. If you and the pharmacies are in business alliance with the groceries, then the pharmacist may signpost that patient that after your child takes this medicine, they need fruits. And we know a grocery where best fresh fruit can be found. And the mama goes to the grocery and buys those fruits. When the child heals, you'll be sure the mother will tell others about that good doctor who will signpost you the best pharmacist, who will signpost you the best fruit too. So those are business alliances. Those are some partners. How often do we forget those? So how do you identify business alliances? This is something we can help you. Number 9, cost structure now. You have done all the problem, you identified it. You identified who it affects, the customer segments. You have designed the value proposition, the solution that is probably better than the competitors. Then you have developed your customer relationships. Maybe you have a data bank for the relation, for the customers with their, let's say, their birthdays or the parties for children, so that every birthday you send a birthday card, relationships are sustained. Then you have the channels of reaching your customers, maybe through borders if you want, through online and all that. Those channels are relevant and appropriate to your business. Then you have the key activities. You have identified the key resources and the key partners. You are now in a position to cost your business, because all the 1 up to 8 have costs. So now you do your cost structure, which is defined as the monetary cost of operating a business. Fixed costs, variable costs, you need to know which ones are which. How much does it cost to achieve my business's key activities? You need to do that costing. What are the costs of my key resources and key partnerships? Business alliance, for example, that we said. How much does it cost to achieve the value proposition for my customers and users? In a nutshell, this is costing the business. Many businesses are poorly costed, and therefore they run into problems. And finally, you want to smile all the way into the bank. You want to look at the revenue streams, which are defined as the way by which your business converts your value proposition or solution to the customer's problem into financial gain, making money. It is also important to understand the pricing in your business. The question becomes, what are my different revenue streams? When we were doing the marketing plan for Makueni County juice plant, that's mango juice plant, fruit juice plant in Makueni, we identified and proposed a charcoal briquette revenue streams from mango peels. You know, Makueni was going to produce juices. But when you produce juices, you have the mango peels remaining behind. Are you going to throw them away? Can that be a revenue stream? The mango stones can make cattle feed. So can you also make what is supposed to be waste? Can you convert it in revenue stream? So it's important to identify some revenue streams that otherwise may be hidden. So the original plan of Makueni County didn't have that, but when we did, we proposed it. How well it has been taken is another question altogether. The point here where I want to say that, look at your business. If it's a restaurant, the remnants of the the food, can it make revenue streams? The water, that oil water that you're washing your plates, and is there anything good you can do with it? Yes. So those are our 10 steps. If you enjoyed it, please like it, share it, and subscribe. You'll be alerted every time we post more on this channel, and we're going to post a lot more. We do research to come up with this information. So if you feel like supporting us, just go to our website, www.mukmik.co.ke. We can actually train your groups, can train you, we can do for you the business plan for your business, whether individual or corporate, we can do that. So reach our director, who is speaking, via wihem@gmail.com. Thank you, and please plan your business. Don't just, you know, dive into the business. You will sink. You will not survive. But with the planning, you increase your chances of survival. Thank you, and have an entrepreneurial day. Won't you?